Welcome back. We'll start with chapter 8 in classics history. Now this chapter talks about Ashoka, the emperor who finally gave up war. Before we start with Ashoka, we'll start with how the Mauryan dynasty worked. So the first of the major rulers under Mauryan dynasty was Chandragupta Maurya. He was succeeded by his son Bindusara, who was finally succeeded by his son Ashoka. So in this class, we would later on focus on Ashoka. For now, let's understand the Maurya dynasty as such and a little about Chandragupta Maurya. So Chandragupta Maurya was supported by his vice person or the key man, who was Chanakya. The other name for Chanakya was Kautilya, and he wrote the book which was known as Arthashastra. Under Arthashastra, he explained the various techniques to fight war. Again, under Arthashastra, he explained India as divided under Northwest and South. So in Northwest, he explained it's mainly the blankets that are common, and in South India, it's mainly the gold and the precious stones that are important. So that was what Chanakya explained in his book Arthashastra. Now, when we talk about Chandragupta Maurya, he was the first emperor who started the Magadha dynasty. So in this map, you can see the hierarchy in the development of the the Mauryan dynasty. So this was the initial Magadha that could be seen. Under Chandragupta's conquest, this was the area of northern India that became part of the Mauryan dynasty. When Chandragupta defeated the Alexander and Seleucus, so you have the parts of the present Pakistan which became part of the empire or the dynasty of Chandragupta. Later on, he conquered the southern India, parts of southern India, and finally under the Ashokan empire, under Ashoka, the parts of Kalinga in Odisha and southern India came under Mauryan dynasty. So that was the final map or the final extent, we can say, of the Mauryan dynasty. So it not only covers the present day India, but rather the Indian subcontinent. So that was the expanse of Chandragupta and Ashoka during the time of Ashoka. And finally, this map shows those marked in the blue reveals the conquest areas of Chandragupta, and those in the southern India are parts of the Ashokan Empire. Now the next one is the map for the Mauryan dynasty. As we said, that most of the Indian subcontinent became part of the conquest of Mauryan dynasty. Now we have three things that we have underlined here: Takshila, Ujjain and Pataliputra. Now Pataliputra was the main capital of the Mauryan dynasty. Since Pataliputra was the capital, the region near Pataliputra was ruled by the emperor itself. The area under Mauryan dynasty was so huge that it was difficult to be ruled from a single seat. Therefore, Takshila and Ujjain became the provisional capitals. So these two were the provisional capitals. And why were these important? That is again very important to understand. Takshila was important because it was a connecting link from Central Asia. So it was one of the major centers which became the connecting link of India from Central Asia. And Ujjain was a provisional capital because it was a connecting link between the North India and the South India. So therefore, Takshila and Ujjain came up as provisional capitals, and you have Pataliputra which was the capital. Now Pataliputra, as we said, the regions near Pataliputra were under the direct control of the emperor. So these were, I could say in simple terms, the best ruled of areas. So officials were at high alert. There were spies behind the officials to see their day-to-day work. Army was maintained in huge number. Again, when Ashoka adopted the Buddhism, there were various Buddhist sites that came up. Some of the important ones were Sarnath, Sachi, Bodh Gaya and Barbar Caves. So these were some of the major Buddhist sites which came up. Now there were a lot of work in field of road, rivers. So basically the focus was transportation. So if there is good transportation, good communication links, they could have more conquest and expand their territory to more huge areas or cover more areas in simple terms. Now, Mauryan dynasty is known as an empire. It is not known as a kingdom. So what is the difference between kingdom and an empire? Empire is ruled by an emperor and it is much larger in contrast to a kingdom. Now when we say it's much larger, it's larger in terms of the resources that it has. It is larger in terms of the area. It maintains a much bigger army and collects much higher taxes as compared to the kingdom. Now when we say tax, again, there was tribute that was common under the Mauryan period. So what is the difference between tax and a tribute? So tax is something that is levied either monthly, quarterly, semi-annually or annually, and it's the fixed amount that a person has to pay or a fixed proportion that he has to pay. Tribute, on the other hand, is a willing contribution that a person does, and this contribution could vary in amount, could vary in things. So there is kind of variety of coverage under a tribute, and tribute is something that a person willingly offers to the empire. So that was the basic difference between tribute and tax during that time. Now, Seculus, who was one of the Greek leaders or the Greek kings, he had an ambassador who was known as Megasthenes. Now, Megasthenes has been important in Indian history because Megasthenes has written a lot about Indian history. When he first visited India, he wrote about two basic things of the Mauryan Empire or the Mauryan period. He wrote about the Mauryan king and he wrote about the city of Pataliputra. When he was explaining the Mauryan king, he explained the grandeur of the Mauryan period, the Mauryan kings, how they used to live, the palaces, the forts built during that time. They were all made of wood with stone carvings. Again, he explained that there was huge chances that someone could kill a king. Therefore, every food that was offered to the king was tasted prior to being offered to the king by the servants. Again, the king never used to sleep in the same room for more than 2 days. That was a means of, again, a security measure. When it comes to Pataliputra, he said the whole city was surrounded by wall with nearly 570 watchtowers and 64 gates. As we said, that the palace was made of wood and most of the major buildings were again made of wood. There were ample of gardens. Now, Romila Thapar in his book explains the statements by Megasthenes where she says that there are 7 castes which were divided based on the occupation during the Mauryan period, and those were philosophers, who were exempted from paying any taxes, farmers, soldiers, herdsmen, artisans, magistrates and counselors. So these were the major occupations during that time. Now let's come on to the major topic for today, that's Ashoka. Now Ashoka is known for being the first person to have written inscriptions. Now his inscriptions were written mainly in Prakrit, which was written in the script which was known during that time as Brahmi. So Brahmi script, and this was later on deciphered after many years by James Prinsep. So James Prinsep was the first person who deciphered the Ashokan inscriptions. Now Ashokan inscriptions were written in rocks, pillars, and there are many other edicts that are seen for Ashoka. Now the most important part of Ashoka's life was the war that he fought at Kalinga. Now Kalinga war was a kind of landmark in the history of the world because it was a kind of unbeatable conquest that Ashoka had done, and he finally won the war. But after the war, he realized that there was lot of bloodshed. There were nearly 1.5 lakh people who died, 1.5 lakh people who were injured. So more or less there was a kind of tragic history of nearly 3 lakh people at that time that was seen during the Kalinga war. There were many Brahmins and monks that died during the war. As a result, Ashoka realized that there need to be some other way to achieve or to conquest, and therefore he realized a new path which was known as Dhamma. So Dhamma is a Prakrit word for the Sanskrit word which is Dharma. So he followed or he preached another kind of method to conquest, and that was dharma, or through the good sake that a person can do. He was the only king who gave up conquest even after winning a war. So that's again a kind of landmark in the history. Now, there are various pillars that have been found from the Mauryan period. One of these is found in the Rampurwa in Bihar, which is now a part, or which has now been established in the Rashtrapati Bhavan in India. Now, when Ashoka explained his dharma, or the dharma, he explained there is no god or no sacrifice. It's everything is human deed. So ultimately, karma is the main thing, and what he taught his subjects should be preached to other generations. He saw a lot of distress around himself. So he saw families who are having quarrels among themselves. Then he saw animal sacrifices being taking place. He saw that slaves are being ill-treated, and all these things ultimately changed his heart. He was inspired by Buddha, and he appointed Dhamma Mahamata, that is the person who would preach the teachings of Buddha and would establish or would spread the Buddhism along. So all his messages, all his teachings regarding the dharma or the non-violence, compassion towards other animals, respect towards animals, treating all creatures at an equal level, were some things that were embedded as messages on rocks and pillars. He sent people far and wide across the world to Syria, Egypt, Greece and Sri Lanka for spreading the concept of dharma and ultimately spreading the Buddhism. He also helped people with medical treatments and providing housing facilities. Now, what was next after the Mauryan dynasty is something that is very, very important. Now, we saw during the Mauryan period, it was nearly whole of the Indian subcontinent which was part of the Mauryan dynasty. But this did not remain later on after the Mauryan dynasty vanished off. After the Mauryan dynasty collapsed around 2200 years ago, there was a brief or an intermittent period of Indo-Greeks in North India. These Indo-Greeks remained for nearly 100 years. So right now we are talking about Northwest India. So Northwest India, you have the Greco-Bactrian kingdom, as you can see here. And there were Indo-Greeks for nearly 100 years. These Indo-Greeks were succeeded by Shakas, who ruled for nearly 400 years. After Shakas, they were defeated by Gupta Empire. So you had Guptas that came up, and you had the Kushvanas that came up in the northwest. Coming on to the north and the central India, Mauryan dynasty was succeeded by Pushpamitra Shunga, who was the propounder of the Shunga dynasty. So you have this Shunga dynasty, as you can see here. So this was the part which was North India and Central India. So Mauryan dynasty was succeeded by the Shunga Empire. This Shunga Empire was later on succeeded by Kanavs and finally to Guptas. So that was something, the rule that occurred in the central and the northern India. Coming on to the western parts, you have Shakas, which were followed by the Satavahanas. So you have the Satavahana kingdom, or the Satavahana empire, that could be seen here. And these Satavahanas ruled for nearly 400 years, and finally these Satavahanas were succeeded by Vakatakas. So you have, after Satavahana, you have the Vakatakas here. And finally comes the South India. In the South India, the Mauryan Empire was further succeeded by three kingdoms, which were known as Chola, Chera and Pandya. However, later on, these three were further succeeded by Pallavas and Chalukyas. So as you can see, whole of the India was broken down into smaller and smaller empires and kingdoms, and never again in the history there was such a huge empire that revived back. So these were some of the major things that occurred. Now, when we are talking about the Mauryan dynasty in India, before the Mauryan dynasty, as we see in all of the chapters in the NCERT, towards the end you have a kind of international event that is highlighted. So before the Mauryan history, there was a similar happening in the world scenario, and that was the building up of the Great Wall of China, which was nearly 2400 years ago. Now, contrary to what Ashoka did, China was trying to protect itself from the attacks of the Mongols from the north. As a result, they built up the Great Wall of China, which is nearly 6400 kilometers long and has watch towers at nearly every 100 and 200 kilometers. In addition to that, it took nearly 2000 years to shift the various boundaries of the Great Wall of China, and the frontiers got shifted at various points in time with the different empires that came into power. We'll be talking more about this when we'll be working around the topics on world history. With this, we covered the chapter 8 of NCERT class 6. We'll be covering more topics in the further lectures. Till then, stay tuned. Have a good day ahead.